7 days after the Hamas terror attack on Israel on October the 7th, the Jewish state is on the threshold of its biggest ground offensive in history into the Palestinian territory of Gaza. Now, you've been watching India Today's Gaurav Savant, my colleague, reporting from the front line as endless columns of Israeli Merkava battle tanks roll towards the Gaza Strip as we speak. A galvanized Israel intends to keep rolling until Hamas is obliterated in all its forms. The question, though, is what about Iran? That's right, what about Iran? A huge country in the region that has direct links with Hamas. A country whose role in the October 7th attack, even at this early stage, is beyond doubt. Nobody has any misconceptions about that. A country that has supplied everything from rockets to anti-tank weaponry to drones to Hamas, alongside valuable funding to train generations of jihadis. And it is believed a safe haven for the Hamas leadership whenever they have needed it. Iran hasn't fought a full-scale war in many decades now, but flexes its muscle via groups like the Hamas and the Islamic Jihad in Gaza, like the Hezbollah in Lebanon. Media reports suggest that Iran may have had more than just a supporting role. The Wall Street Journal, for instance, reports that members of the Iranian Revolutionary Guard may have visited Lebanon to actually sign off on the October 7th attack by the Hamas 6 days before it happened. Now, Iran, of course, has denied all such reports of its involvement, but has, not unexpectedly, welcomed the attack by Hamas and openly congratulated both the Hamas and its leader, Ismail Haniyeh, who is known to live a protected life in Qatar, as I showed you on my show just a couple of days ago. Now, Iran's proxy battles in the region are now very well known, but the question is why? You're asking, what does Iran have to gain from this? What does Iran gain from supporting Hamas, supplying it via smuggling tunnels with rockets, anti-tank weaponry, drones, anti-aircraft missiles, mines, light machine guns, and so much more? The issue, viewer, is this. Prior to the October 7th attack, Israel's relationship with the Arab and Muslim world was heading slowly in the direction of normalcy after decades of animosity. President Joe Biden of the United States, in fact, was famously attempting to mediate a Saudi-Israel link, a handshake that would get these two big countries, for the first time in history, Saudi and Israel, to see each other as nations rather than bitter adversaries who need to be destroyed. In September this year, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu met with Turkish President Recep Erdogan, whose own government has been a supporter of Hamas and has always been virulently anti-Israel. Netanyahu and Erdogan meeting on the sidelines of the UN General Assembly has hinted at a new normalization of that broken relationship between Israel and Turkey. So there is a hint of normalization in that direction as well. As a nation that poisonously calls for the direction of Israel, Iran itself had seen a path of normalcy appear with the United States. The Biden administration earlier this year, viewer, had taken a decision to unfreeze $6 billion of Iran's money, allowing it to access that money after decades of sanctions, in exchange for the release of 5 American prisoners. While the U.S. says now that it is still investigating Iran's role in the Hamas attack, Iran, for the moment, can just forget about those $6 billion, obviously. The attack has additionally given people like Donald Trump a juicy opportunity to claim vindication, since he had ferociously attacked President Biden over the $6 billion in aid deal with Iran. Expect this to become a huge election issue in America as Biden heads into the polls next year. Iran is a very, very touchy topic in U.S. politics, as you know. But the question now is, with everything that we know and everything that will emerge after investigations, will Iran face any consequences of any kind from Israel or from the United States? Yesterday we saw how Israel had launched missile attacks on 2 airports in Syria, in Damascus and Aleppo. These were said to be preemptive strikes to send out a message. Now, Syria and Iran are, of course, not the same. Syria, after years of war, is a depleted force with no real military to speak of. And the ISIS is a formidable strength in several areas of Syria. Iran, on the other hand, viewer, has a full-fledged military capable of taking on a power potentially like Israel. Now, the U.S. Gerald Ford aircraft carrier battle group that's headed into the Mediterranean and arrived there on Tuesday, we are told, isn't just for solidarity with Israel, make no mistake, and I'll tell you a little bit about this a little later. It is an unmissable American message to perhaps Iran more than any other country. As the global spotlight now rests on Gaza, the shadow of Iran is only set to darken. Now, the war between Israel and Hamas, if you haven't noticed it already, is like a vortex with a potential to drag other Arab states into it. We've already seen Syria, we've seen Lebanon, the Hezbollah attacking Israel, attacks happening in Syria, Israel making different noises, other Arab countries hailing the Hamas as well. So what's going to happen next? How does all of this surround sound around the Gaza Strip in Israel affect what's going on right there on the ground? Lebanon and Syria, have already been dragged into it. Most other Arab nations are on the verge of deciding. With each passing day, this war escalates, and there is a risk of a catastrophic expansion beyond what we can see.
There's a war raging in Israel between Hamas and the Israel Defense Forces. And like in all wars, there are others. Some neighbors, some allies who play key roles. And some who try to act as mediators in this war, which has a potential of turning into a much larger conflict that can engulf the entire world. Israel by the Mediterranean Sea is surrounded by Arab League countries. They are at war with Hamas, the militant Palestine Islamist group. Of the 22 Arab League countries, Lebanon's Hezbollah and Syria have already trained their guns at Israel as it started airstrikes on Palestinian ghetto of Gaza. In fact, within hours of Hamas attack on Israel on 7th October, Hezbollah supporters gathered at the Israel border. Another key player in the Arab League, the United Arab Emirates, has warned the Assad regime in Syria not to intervene in the Hamas-Israel war or to allow attacks on Israel from Syrian soil. But Syria has already defied the diktat. Israel's immediate neighbors, Egypt and Jordan, haven't yet joined the war, but have strong words of condemnation for Israel. Jordan suggests a two-nation theory solution as proposed in the 1967 accord, but doesn't hesitate to threaten to stand by Palestinians against Israel.
Jordan's stance will remain steadfast, and we will not stray away from our role despite challenges in defending sacred Islamic and Christian venues in Jerusalem and protecting them under Hashemite custodianship.
Egyptian President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi called the escalation in Gaza highly dangerous, and that Egypt was pushing with regional and international partners for a negotiated solution to the violence. In the last few days, people from Gaza have gathered at Rafah border, which is the only crossing point into Egypt's Sinai. The rest of the Gaza Strip is surrounded by Israel and the sea. A key player in the Middle East, Saudi Arabia, has been in talks with Israel about normalizing relations, as it also walked a fine line. It called for an immediate end to the violence, but did not explicitly denounce Hamas. An agreement with Israel was in the process while Hamas launched its attack. That deal is now in deep freeze.
One of the reasons it carried out its attack now is because of the prospect of normalization between Israel and Saudi Arabia. And over the past few weeks, even months, Hamas officials have been quite open about the fact that this would be a huge event.
The other key Arab League member, Qatar, has offered to mediate while playing host to Hamas leaders, including its chairman, Ismail Haniyeh. And then there are the other non-Arab Islamist countries who are playing key roles, like Turkey.
We openly oppose the killing of civilians on Israeli soil. Likewise, we never accept the massacring of innocent people in Gaza through constant indiscriminate bombing. Cutting off a city's water, electricity, entry and exits, collapsing its infrastructure, destroying all of its centers of worship from mosques to churches, as well as their schools, preventing people from getting the most fundamental needs, and bombing housing units where civilians reside. In other words, managing a conflict using every sort of embarrassing method is not a war. It's a massacre.
Turkey has backed Palestinians in the past and hosted members of Hamas. It has been working to mend its ties with Israel after years of animosity. Unlike the European Union and United States, Ankara does not consider Hamas a terrorist organization. And then there are the non-Arab states like Iran, who have been speaking up for Hamas from day one, but don't enjoy good relations with Saudi Arabia and some of the other Arab nations. As the war rages on, it surely widens the fissures between the Arab countries and has the possibility of bringing in more Islamist states in its purview, leading to greater destabilization of the region.